Welcome to another episode of Breakaway from the Rat Race. And today I have the pleasure of speaking with Coach Carol, who is the CEO of Carol Media. And Coach Carol is a sales psychology and advertising strategy expert. He focused and helped a lot of people achieve their business goal through social media and advertising strategy, obviously. He's an author, a speaker, and he travels the country motivating, inspiring, and training entrepreneurs in social media strategies and how to make the most of their advertising budget, which is very important, obviously. But also, Coach Carol is a real estate investor. And so we're going to start with that. And but Coach Carol, welcome to the show.
Yeah, thanks so much for having me, Eric. Yeah, you know, while I spend most of my time in the business world being an entrepreneur, I'm also a real estate investor. So I'm excited to be on the podcast, hopefully give the listeners some tips and tricks that they can take away and use in their, what I consider their business, right? If you're an investor, you're in business, whether you want to be or not. But I'm excited to be here on the podcast and really appreciate you having me.
Yeah, and so my pleasure. It's a great honor to have you on the show. And the reason why I mentioned your real estate investment career too is kind of like to really show that, you know, this is, you understand kind of like the real estate investment business. And as you mentioned, this is something that is, you know, when you get into that, you're in business, you're an entrepreneur. It's a real mindset change from, you know, where you, if you're a full-time employee into an entrepreneur, into a business owner. So it's a little bit different, quite a bit different, actually. So tell us a little bit about your real estate investment career, and then we can take it from there.
Yeah, sounds good, man. So I started my first business my senior year of high school. I bought my first piece of real estate when I was 21 years old. I was going to be a chemical engineer and decided my senior year of high school, I bought a Walmart weed eater, a Walmart push mower with $100 I'd borrowed from my grandma, $100 I'd borrowed from my mom, and then $100 I'd saved up working 3 part-time jobs, a gas station, bussing tables and delivering pizzas, and said, hey, I'm going to go try this working for myself thing. And here we are. I'm 33 now. I've sold and bought over a dozen businesses, or currently hold, you know, somewhere in the dozen business mark. And, you know, like I said, I bought my first house when I was 21 years old. It was a 2-bedroom, 1-bath house that was absolutely appalling, had green shag carpet, drywall, had holes in it. I think it had the original appliances from 1964 inside of this thing. And, but it was the typical break into the real estate game where I was going to buy this thing. I was going to live in it as a single family property for 2 years so that I could then sell it tax-free. And we'll talk about some of those advantages later in the show. But, you know, I put my blood, sweat, and tears into this thing, build up that sweat equity, which is so important in the real estate game if you're just getting started. And, you know, when I was 21 years old, I didn't have a lot of money, but the money I did have saved up, you know, I built this property up and lived there for a couple of years, and then eventually refinanced it, moved out and turned it into a rental. And so, you know, there's definitely a lot of strategies you can use, but bought my first property when I was 21. I bought my second house, I think when I was 25. And in the middle there, I also did a couple of wholesale deals. One went really, really well. One I completely lost my ass on. And then I also flipped a mobile housing unit. You know, I do live in Kentucky, so we've got some trailers here, some mobile homes. And I wore my shoes today, those guys. Don't worry. I'm not full hillbilly on you.
You know, these trailer parks are everywhere. I mean, I'm in California. That's right, yeah. I mean, there's some in near San Francisco. People don't really know them until you're looking for trailer park opportunities. They're everywhere, even in the best places. Anyway, I interrupted. Keep going,
though. No, you're fine. So yeah, so I've definitely built, you know, my first business was a lawn and landscape business. I grew that to $3 million in revenue and sold it. But again, I've always stayed in touch with real estate because I've yet to find a mentor of mine, and I've been seeking out mentors since I was 18 years old. I've yet to find a mentor that didn't have their hands in some form of real estate. Meaning, you know, they maybe they they flipped properties and had a construction crew on the side, or all the way to the most removed, which is something that I do, which is syndicating deals to where, you know, they just put their money in and let somebody else run that so they can go play golf and not have to worry about leaky toilets or running appliances. But, you know, for me, it's kind of been cool over the past decade and a half to kind of see how real estate has changed. You know, here in the Louisville market, 5 or 6 years ago, I syndicated a deal. We bought about 60 units. I now have around 70 to 75. Actually looking at a 7-unit deal right now that we're going to put under contract this week. And it's been crazy, the inflation over the past 24 months, 36 months. You know, I was able to buy a house 3 or 4 years ago for $30,000, put another 10 to 15 in it, and then Section 8 rent that out for $750 to $850 a month. Really good returns, right? Less than $50K in, you're getting $800 a month on average back out of it. Pretty solid returns, and it's guaranteed money. Eric, I got to tell you, now, bro, now you can't find a house for less than $50,000 with someone living in it. Wow. They're paying $30,000 to $40,000 a house that are boarded up. And so we've definitely seen the market kind of swing a little bit. I think there's a correction coming in the next, you know, 2 to 3 years, not trying to play Nostradamus, but typically what you see is once the rates start going back up, the market cools down. I think we'll bring back a first-time house buyer tax credit again. That's how I bought my first house. You know, the bank took my tax, $8,000 tax credit, and that's what they used as my down payment so I could get in it. So I think we'll see that, but, you know, the real estate market never ends, right? Like there's never like people hear crash and they're like, oh, it's the end of it. It's like, no, it's just cycles. It goes up for 10 years. It goes down for 10 years. Yeah. And so, you know, one of the biggest things that pushed me to get into real estate, to stay into real estate, to continue to be in real estate is the fact that, you know, those mentors of mine that I met that were worth millions of dollars, some of them were tens or hundreds of millions of dollars. They, no matter how big or small their business was, they always had their fingers in real estate, some form or fashion. So, you know, we can talk about that a little bit more sure today, but that's what kind of drove me to get involved in it and what's kind of kept me involved up to this day.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I think that's true. I mean, a lot of the mentors, a lot of the people like successful business people, you know, all of them end up having to, and if they're going to diversify, if they have a successful business, if they have whatever they have going on, a successful career that making a lot of money, they want to diversify into real estate, even in the stock market. You want to diversify in the real estate. And in fact, I mean, when I'm looking at it, if I had to start like with a blank sheet of paper, you know, I talk to people about that too. Say, so, okay, just start with a blank sheet of paper and imagine the best investment possible. I want to be able to put 20% of the money down, but still have a control 100% of the asset. I want to be able to have receive passive income on a regular basis. I want to be able to the thing to appreciate over time. I want to be able to and get tax incredible tax benefits. So when you put all that together, I mean, there's not that many investment. There's nothing on the stock market that's like that. There's nothing in there's nothing like that. This is the most the best investment. And when you look at the tax code, it's written for real estate investors. I mean, you know, so if you're not part of that, if you're not taking advantage of that, I mean, you're missing out.
Absolutely. Definitely. Yeah, you know, that's I made a post on my Facebook, and you got the people that are listening, you can follow me. It's hashtag Coach Carroll, C-A-R-R-O-L-L. Any social media platform, just put that in the search bar, I'll pop up. I made a post the other day. It was like, you know, the system's not fair. Learn to play in it.
Exactly. Exactly.
Like we've kind of become the society where we want to bitch and moan about how everything's not fair and everything's not, you know, equal. And it's like, okay, So then learn how to play in it. You know, we always hear these, especially around election time, you always hear this talk about tax rates and they're like, oh, is tax rates going up or going down? I'm like, look, I don't care what you make my tax rate. Just don't change the tax code. That's what I don't want affected because I actually got audited when I was 24. I hope the IRS is listening to this. I got audited when I was 24 years old. My businesses were still young. I only did like $480,000 in gross income that year. They audited me because I had like $40,000 in other expenses. After paying my attorney a couple $1,000s, paying my CPA a couple $1,000s for the day, you know, we went up there and my books are clean. I'm a solid business guy. I follow the rules. They hit me with like $83 in, you know, missed deductions or whatever it was. And, you know, I wish they would have just came and tried to shake me down for a couple $100 so I didn't have to deal with it. Right.
Exactly.
But the tax code, you said this perfectly, Eric, that the tax code is written for people to be enterprising individuals. That's what our country was founded upon, was enterprising individuals. If you look at our forefathers, even George Washington, I mean, the guy had farms, he had businesses. There's not the whole ideology around work a 40-hour work week and get your paycheck and, you know, you got to give Uncle Sam, it's the rich dad, poor dad formula, right? It's like you get your paycheck, you get taxed, you get what's left over. A business owner gets to make money all year long, gets to spend money all year long. Yeah. And then at the end of the year on April 15th, the tax guy shows up and says, hey man, do you have anything left over for me? And 9 times out of 10, I tell him no to kick rocks, you know, and then every couple of years, I'll throw him a bone because you got to give him a little bit from time to time. But, you know, for us with real estate, I think that there's a huge advantage. You hit the nail on the head, man. You can take your income proceeds, you can invest them into passive-ish type investments. The only time, and I'll tell your listeners this, Eric, the only time you're really going to have truly passive investments in real estate is if you syndicate a deal, if you're truly an investor, which means you put, have you talked about syndication on your show before? I'm not sure.
We did talk about some syndication in the podcast before. So that was very interesting. We have some of them that were actually promoters syndication. They had their own syndication deal that they were promoting and all of that and kind of explaining the process there.
So, okay. Well, that's to me, in my opinion, that's the only truly passive, you know, investing is when you invest that way, because typically, even if you invest and hire a third party management company, you're still going to have to work with that management company. Mm-hmm. You're still going to have to review profit and loss statements and see the performance of your property. But, wrapping all that thought, I got a little sidetracked there, but, I definitely think that real estate investing is something that people can do, and that the tax code is certainly geared in a way that allows them to benefit from that. And it's something that, you know, it's there for the taking, I guess is probably the best way to say it.
Well, yeah, exactly. So that's what I'm trying to, you know, convince people. And I know it takes a little bit of an effort, right? Like everything else, like, you know, I have people talking to me and say, I want to pay less taxes and stuff like that. Well, are you invested in real estate? Like, oh no, but that seems too bad. What do you want to do? Like, yeah, if you're going to have a W-2, this is what you're going to get. W-2, the income tax is paid at the source, all of that. If you want to reduce your taxes, you have to be in business. And if you want to, more importantly, if you want to increase your income, that's what you have to do. I mean, if you work as a full-time employee, I mean, you're basically dependent on the company saying, oh, you know, what a great job you've done. Here's a 3% increase. And here's a little bit something else, you know, to help you along. But, you know, that's not going to get you to where you are. You want to be investing. You want to be, and that this is where the benefits are. But it takes more effort. And not many people are not willing to take that that extra effort and learn how the system works. So, and also in my book, I talk about that as well, because my parents used to look at it and say, and they would know, we had some business people, obviously in the small little town that I worked in, and my parents didn't know anything about business. And then they would see this guy that's just like, oh yeah, well, his store went bankrupt and he still has his car. He still has his house. he still goes on vacation. He's a crook. You know, it's just like, no, he took advantage of the system. He created an entity. And as you mentioned, you know, earlier, it's the system is made for enterprising individual people that if you want to build a country, you want people that are going to take some risk and then you want to reward them. And that's why the system is built the way it is. So, and I don't think we're planning on changing that. I think we want to move forward. We want to grow the country as far as I know.
Hope not. I hope they don't change it. That's, you know, that's the problem that you have is that when you come in and you try to say that a system is corrupt and then by default, the people that have been successful in said system are now the villain. And when you say that the villain is only victorious because he took advantage of the people that weren't successful, now you're placing yourself as the hero. And that's a difficult person to argue with, right? Because now you're trying to defend yourself against someone that is the savior of the people that have been disadvantaged in the system. Yeah. And so hopefully there's more people that have sense in this country that knows that what we've been able to accomplish as a country is something amazing. And, you know, there's still, you know, thousands and thousands of people a month that are just dying to get in this country because they know that that America is a great place to be and we have the opportunity. And real estate is one of the big pieces of that, man, is, you know, having the ability to make money off of rental properties or flip houses or wholesales. And because that's the thing is like there's a ton of ways to make money. And then you get into the other like sub twos where, you know, you can get somebody's house, you can take over their mortgage, make their payment, they move out and then you rent it out to somebody else and you make the difference in the split. There's so many ways to make money with real estate.
It's amazing. Yeah, it's pretty amazing. It's pretty amazing. That's for sure. You have obviously done a lot of wide range of real estate investment and real estate activity. This is very good. Mm-hmm. And now you do a lot of on the social media. Obviously, that's what you're doing, sales psychology, advertising strategy for social media. Yep. So is there something that real estate investors like myself and like other people can leverage in their day-to-day business to help grow what they're trying to do in real estate?
Yeah. You know, one of the big things that I see are, you know, large property management companies, when they take over 300, 400, and 500 unit properties, they're still using antiquated systems like apartments.com or forrent.com. And they're not building their own brand. They're not building a brand for the property. Now, this is a little more difficult to do with individual homes, with single family, but when you have property scatter sites, for instance, you know, the seven unit deal that I'm looking at right now here in Louisville, it's around a school that just had $40 million put into it. And so we think that this is going to be a new hub for tech and innovation for it's a K-12 school. And so we plan on marketing. That's the kind of in our outlook for this site as we're underwriting the deal. We think that there's a $200 per unit upside on the rents because we could market this as, you know, a unit that a single, you know, a single mom with a kid could move into, and the kid could be within walking distance of one of the best schools in the neighborhood. And that's how we plan to promote it on social in that way. And so what that does is now you're creating brand awareness. You can demand higher rents. The other thing is if you get away from, you know, on bigger properties like forrent.com or apartments.com, you know, those are closed loop systems. And so you're stuck paying a monthly fee versus just building a brand that is, you know, can be built off of word of mouth and social media so that people are like, wow, I want to live at this place because everyone writes great reviews. Everyone's, you know, they're having social media event. They're having events that they can see on social media. There's definitely some power that you can use to brand that. Because I want to make this really clear too, Eric, because there may be some business owners listening is like 20 years ago, there was only offline business. There was only the real world, right? Like I'm sitting in my house right now. This was real. Now we have this, technology, we have this online world. So simultaneously, it's kind of like the Matrix. Like there's a whole nother world that's happening online while everybody else lives their real life. And so as long as business owners, investors, they can wrap their head around that we essentially exist in two different places now, you know, it will change the way that they do business. It will change the way that they interact with their clients or customers, and honestly, the way that they build brands.
Mm-hmm. Yes, I think, so that's very interesting about, so I do have apartment buildings as well. And so I think, yeah, kind of branding them on social media, we actually haven't really done that. I mean, we are using different portals and like you mentioned, like apartments.com and all of that. Then we're relying also on our property manager, have the property, have a page for the property, maybe even a website for the property itself. Yeah. To basically, you know, kind of like promote and then get people there to that apartment. One of the times we used social media was actually to attract some tenants, and then we just used Instagram and stuff like that and showed pictures of the apartment. And this is in Memphis, and it's just like, yeah, we got tons of people that were interested. That we just like, what? What just happened? All of a sudden, you have like 10 people that are interested in an apartment. It's just like, it was phenomenal.
Yeah. So I'll tell you too, when you create a brand, you instantly get a demand higher prices, right? You know, the no-name brand tennis shoe that sells at Walmart can only charge so much money. But when Nike attaches LeBron James to a tennis shoe, they now demand top dollar because there are two ginormous brands attached to that product they're selling. Still a tennis shoe, but there's branding power. And so I think that happens with, you know, with real estate. I think too often, and we see this, and this is why I love buying deals that are where there's market movement, you have the ability to increase these rents.
So do you think that, so let's say you have an investor that has a small portfolio of single family rentals. Is there a way you think that, that you would recommend maybe to use social media to kind of like brand all these, that small portfolio under one umbrella?
Yeah. So with single family, I think you have to brand your quote unquote management company, right? You know, and talk about how great you keep the units. One thing that I'm very proud of is the majority of my portfolio is, you know, government assisted housing. So low income housing, rental assisted housing. So what we've found is a lot of times our tenants suffer from not being very financially literate. And so we have an online course that we make available to all of our tenants. You know, we don't charge really for it. It's just something that's free that I've kind of done as a value add. Yeah, I'll tell you, Eric, it was one of those things where it was kind of my way of giving back. You know, I didn't want to just get in real estate for the sole purpose. I don't really do any business for the sole purpose of making money. Yeah. There always has to be a higher purpose for me to really be engaged and excited about it. Yeah. And so we made a financial literacy course that, you know, kind of teaches people about spending habits and things like that. Because honestly, let's face it, you know, a lot of times there's this narrative painted that, you know, poor people are poor because they're disadvantaged. It's like, well, yes, true, some, but some people are poor because they have bad spending habits. Some people are poor because they have addiction problems to like things like gambling. And so by making people aware that are in these situations where they're dependent on government assisted rent, it's our hope and goal that, you know, eventually they move up and out of our properties. You know, they find better jobs, they make more money, they can provide for their families, and they get off of government assistance. You know, something that I've always been told is, you know, government assistance is not something where it's a place you're supposed to stay. You know, it's supposed to help you become more. And so, you know, for the single family, I think if you can create a brand like that, something that you're known for, community service events, things like that, then you're not only going to be able to attract renters more easily, but you're also going to have better relationship with your tenants. Because at the end of the day, your tenants are your clients, right? Mm-hmm. I think there's like somewhere along the line, it got misconstrued that like, just because you own real estate, like, oh, you don't have to care about your renters. Like your renters are your clients. Like there's no other business. Like you don't go through a McDonald's drive-thru, grab a cheeseburger, say, hey, you got my order wrong. And they go, well, we don't care. Next. It's like, what? but that somehow is how real estate works. And I think it's because of the supply and demand curve, honestly, man. You know, I think that there is not enough supply and there's so much demand that people don't have to run a business that way. But, you know, to me, I just, I don't see why you would want to run one that way, but yeah. God knows there's slumlords in every city. So, you know, I just encourage people to try to think of your real estate investment company or your investments and think of, you know, how you could maybe do a little better for your community.
Mm-hmm. So, yeah. So defining a brand would be good around that, you know, that property management or stuff like that, and say, hey, these are my properties and this is what we do and all of that. And then they can kind of like get into your portfolio somehow. Then if you're dealing with a property management company that does the actual admin, you just pass them on to them, I guess, to go and have the tenant visit the property or something like that and negotiate that final contract. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that kind of makes sense. At least you control the social media aspect of it, and then you can kind of leverage that. I wonder if you can have your property management company actually go into social media, into your social media page to do that.
I'm sure if you pay them enough money, you can have them do whatever you want.
One of the things too that we did but that was not social media, but when we started doing things in Memphis, at one point we had all our properties looked very similar color and the outside. We also had shutters also a different color, and then so we would drive through the neighborhood and stuff like that. Oh, this used to be our house. This used to be our house. This is our house. You know, so that was that's kind of interesting, and also it helps. I mean, branding a little bit on in terms of people that want to rent the property. They can see that your property looks a little bit different. And they look well maintained and all of that. So that helps Absolutely. You potentially attract some renters.
For sure.
Yeah. So this is very good. Another thing too that you mentioned is financial literacy. So I want to touch on that because that's pretty important to me as well. And this in my book, I mean, I try to actually I talk about that. I spent about a third of the book on basic financial literacy for people, because I know that a lot of people are interested in real estate. They may know that, yeah, this is what I want to do, but how do I don't know anything about that. I know I get a house and I rent it, but how do I know which house to buy? How do I know that, you know, how do I set it up as a business and all that kind of stuff? So, I'll talk about the structure. I talk about, you know, protecting your asset and all of that, but also about financial literacy in terms of how do you do basic calculate, not necessarily calculation, because it's just like plus and minuses for the most part. But it's how do you organize, I would say, how do you organize your number in such a way that you can compare investment one with investment two? How do you know that your investment is successful or not? So what are some of the key lessons that you found that you're teaching in financial literacy?
Yeah. So, one of the biggest things is not to be afraid of credit. And so I talk about credit a lot of times in high school. So, you know, a lot of times high schools will bring me in to talk to seniors because, you know, my senior year of high school is when I decided I want to be an entrepreneur. I actually turned down 8 football scholarships, and wow. I tried college for about 3 semesters. But my third semester, I wanted to take business finance. So that goes right into the financial literacy, right? I wanted to learn about business financials. And I remember sitting in my office and looking at Heather, which was my guidance counselor. And she said, DJ, I'm sorry, I can't let you take business finance. You don't have the prerequisites. And at the time, you know, I'm mildly dyslexic even to this day. I love audiobooks because my reading comprehension skills terrible. But I said, I don't understand. What do you mean prerequisites? And she goes, well, you haven't taken the right classes to be able to take that class. I was like, okay, so what classes haven't I taken? She said, well, you haven't taken accounting. I was like, all right, that kind of makes sense. You kind of maybe need accounting to learn business finance. And then Eric, she told me I hadn't take history or rock and roll. I said, hold on a second. I have to take history or rock and roll to be able to take business finance, you know? And that was about the time that I was like, yeah, I think I'm just going to go try to figure this out on my own. And, you know, I was one of my very first mentors after I dropped out of college was Herb Kinman. He owned a Chevrolet dealership. He also owned a Dodge dealership. and had tons of rental property. Was this dude was just always willing and dealing. He was in his 70s and still like full of piss and vinegar. And so I remember going in and talking to him one time, and you know, I was asking him about something. He said, "Well, just go get a loan." I was like, "I don't want to get a loan. You know, it's going to be, I got to pay interest." And he said, let me give you a tip, EJ. If you can find a deal that'll pay you 10, 15, 20, 25% returns, don't be greedy." I was like, Herb, I'm not following. I don't get this. What are you talking about?" He said, "If you can find you a deal paying you 10, 15, 20, 25% returns, don't be greedy. Let your banker make 4, 5, or 6% on it." And I'll tell you, Eric, it was like an unlock in my head. I was like, that makes perfect sense. And so to this day, you know, I'll use debt to buy revenue generating assets. And if it doesn't generate revenue, I don't own it. My house, I live in a 4,000 square foot house in a country club neighborhood. I rent. And people are like,
"You rent?" Me too.
Yeah. I mean, you know, they're like, "You rent your home?" I'm like, "Yes, you know, I rent where I live and I own what I can rent to others." And exactly. A lot of times people are like, "Oh, that's a Cardone saying." I'm like, "That's not a Cardone saying, dude. That's a real estate saying. Go interview anybody that has anything to do with real estate. And they'll tell you if it depreciates, you know, and doesn't produce income, why in the world would you want to also pay interest on top of it?" Yeah. And so I lease my vehicles. I actually lease them through my business. Yeah. And that's, you know, that's one of those things where now it's tax deductible. You have to realize, you know, my Escalade is $1,000 a month lease. For me to lease that thing as an employee, I need to take a $2,000 paycheck because the government's going to take half of it. And then I'll have the $1,000 to spend.
Yeah.
With doing it through the business, I make my money, I pay the $1,000, and now it's tax deductible, lowers my taxable income.
Yeah.
So when I talk about financial literacy, I think one of the biggest things is that people are afraid to use debt. They look at it like it's something that's dangerous. But you know, when we're in elementary school, what kind of fireworks do we get to play with? We get to play with sparklers, right? Those are the fun things. Our parents light them for us. We run around the yard like, "Oh my gosh, it's fun." You get into middle school, you know, maybe you get to light a little fountain or like the little tanks that run around on the ground. And then like when you get into high school or become an adult, then you get to play with like mortar shells and like the really cool shit. Credit's the same way, you know, but what happens is we're told, you know, "Well, don't touch it. Don't touch it. Don't touch it. Don't touch it." And then boom, you go off to college and your first interaction with credit is that Victoria's Secrets credit card or the Gap credit card that's 29% interest. And because you weren't taught along the way how to responsibly use it, you don't know what you're doing and then you get yourself in a mess. So I think that our school system fails our people. You know, I think that we should be talking about credit early on in life. I don't have kids, but when I eventually do have kids, they're not going to have one bicycle. They'll have two. They'll have one to ride and one to rent to their friends. you know, there's this ideology, and it's not hard, man. Like I said, I don't consider myself a genius. I started a lawn care company. I'm not too smart, you know, but for me, I think when it comes to financial literacy, the real problem, Eric, and this might be what I'm about to tell you could be a little painful if you're listening to this. The reason most people don't jump into credit is because they don't believe in themselves. Yeah. And it's tough. They simply don't believe in themselves. And if I wouldn't have believed in myself my senior year of high school, I wouldn't be where I'm at right now because I had a chemistry teacher. I had a guidance counselor trying to talk me out of doing anything except for being an entrepreneur. You know, when that guidance counselor and that teacher should have said, "DJ, if that's what you want to do, you want to be in business, let me pick this phone up and let me call the guy that owns a car dealership. Let me call the real estate agent in town. Let me find you a mentor that is a business owner." They did. And they said, no, don't do that. You're throwing your life away, man. You got to go to college. And I just tell people, you have to, in order to be successful in anything in life, you have to believe in yourself when no one else does.
Yeah.
Because if you can't believe in yourself when no one else does, how are you going to succeed?
Yeah. Yeah. And maybe that's true. I think the other part also could be that they're just afraid. They're just going to afraid that they're going to be, if that loan fails, then they're going to lose everything. you know, that's everything is going to be, and this is part of, you know, you have to set up the structure properly so that if something happened and you, for whatever reason, you can't, it doesn't cash flow, or, you know, something happened to the property and stuff like that, and somehow the bank wants the property back, that you, you're not going to affect your personal life and your, you know, go after your own asset. Of course, if you don't own your home and you're renting your home, then they're not going to go after your rent. So
they don't want to start paying your rent. They don't want to pick your lease payment up.
Exactly. You take my rent.
You know, I think too, Eric, is the challenge with when people get in this mindset, fear is a very powerful thing. And when you're fearful, it has the ability to paralyze you.
Yeah.
But what I want your people to understand that are listening to this is, just because you start over doesn't mean you're starting from scratch.
That's right. Yeah. Yeah. Exactly.
I'm going to say that one again, because somebody needs to write that one down. Just because you're starting over doesn't mean you're starting from scratch. One of the biggest real estate fails that I ever had, back in 2015, 2016, I bought a fitness center. And so, this guy, the branding was awful. He was losing money every month. He came to me, said, "Hey, would you be interested?" So yeah, I think there's something I can do here. So I bought the business, which was the goodwill of the business, meaning the logo, the name, everything, and the assets, the equipment. And then we did a owner financing contract on the real estate. So it was $500,000 piece of real estate. And so essentially I held the paper, right? I held the paper on the property. And so every month I would go to the bank and I would make his payment for him. And then I was able to possess the real estate. There's a difference in owning the real estate and possessing the real estate. You know, that you, I think you said something earlier, right? Putting 25% down, but still being in control of 100% of the asset.
Yeah.
There's some things, you know, there's some things that you start, when you start learning this business, you're like, wait a minute, you mean just because I'm holding these 27 pages or 47 page packet, I'm in control now? You know, it's like, it's pretty crazy. But so we had that gym and it was very successful. I mean, I grew it 300% 18 months. The problem was, I had a real estate agent come in, told me that, you know, hey, I've got a buyer. If you'd like to sell the building to us. I told him, hey, no problem, but I need to make sure I can sell the business again, right? I was going to split the deal, make about 50 grand on it. He said, yeah, DJ, we'll put all this, these exclusions and all these things in the contract. This was before I knew there's real estate agents and there's real estate attorneys. You need both. Because the real estate agent is just worried, and I'm sorry if there's agents listening to this, but y'all are just worried about getting that commission check. You don't care what happens. You're trying to push the deal across the line no matter what. And that's what happened. I mean, he pushed the deal across the line. I ended up losing my gym as the business, had to liquidate the assets. I had to give the real estate back to the guy who then sold the business. And, you know, I had a $26,000 loan that I had to carry and pay off. It took me like 3 years to pay that thing off. Luckily, knock on wood, I've never defaulted on any banks. If I've ever owed money to anyone, I've always paid that back. And that's something that I'm very proud to say, but there are ways that you can walk away from properties. And I think you're exactly right, Eric. People are so fearful that if I buy this house and it doesn't work out, then I'm just going to lose everything. It's like, you're not going to lose everything. You know, nine times out of 10, you can sell it for what you paid for it, because real estate appreciates. Also, while your renter's in there, they're going to be paying down the debt.
Yeah.
And then worst case scenario, if you have to sell it for a $10,000 loss, the bank, I promise you, the bank would much rather give you a $10,000 personal loan to make up the gap to let you sell the property. They don't want your property. They're in the business of money, not assets. They don't want to take assets in. They want cash.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, I think that's the thing too, that people think that things are very more set in stone. Like, you think like contracts and all of that. No, you can negotiate anything. Like, you negotiate things. You can negotiate. People think that some things are non-negotiable, but that's not true. I mean, even the banks, I mean, you can negotiate with your bank and say, hey, you know what? This, you know, I want this, I want that. But,
when or I was you find losing, another when bank. When I was losing the gym, I actually went to the banker and I was like, hey, man, just being upfront with you guys, I'm not going to leave you hanging, but I need like 3 or 4 months of no payments so I get myself back in order. They said, okay, no problem.
Yeah.
They would have much rather give me 3, 4, 5, 6. I probably could have got 12 months if I needed it, you know, for that debt to set on their books with no payments to then eventually it be paid off.
Yeah.
Because if they, you also have to realize, and this is some financial like learning literacy, banks get in trouble if they charge off too much debt. Because now when the feds come in and that, well, that's a whole nother ball game. We'll talk about that next time I'm on the
that's
show.
That's another call.
When the feds come in to regulate the banks, if they see that they're writing a bunch of bad loans, the feds say, hey, you're not being good stewards of your money. You're doing bad underwriting on these deals.
Yeah, that's right.
You're not allowed to lend money anymore. You know, that could be the worst case scenario. Yeah. So the banks are very much negotiable. There are very few things in this world that are non-negotiable.
Exactly.
Even when it's written in a contract, 9 times out of 10, there's still some negotiating. Yeah.
You may not get it. You may not get it, but you can always ask.
That's right. That's right.
Right. I mean, you can always write it up, but, I know you mentioned earlier too, kind of like, you know, we're kind of all expecting a little bit of a market correction on the real estate and all of that. And we have there are a lot of people that see like a doomsday in real estate. And my answer to that is that the current real estate situation is very different than what we've seen in 2008. 2008, we had a lot of people that received a loan that they should have never got into. And now we're the people that have loans now, they're good people. They should, the loan was underwritten properly. And it's just a question of now negotiating with the bank in forbearance and say, hey, you know what, I can't pay for, or I haven't paid for 3 months and I need more time to pay and get, and then they're gonna figure something out and then get the loan back up again. So I don't see like a major like foreclosure issue here going on. And I think the government is not gonna let that happen again. I think they've seen the damage that it's done in 2008. And I don't think they want to go into that direction. The banks don't want to go in that direction either, especially now that they have good borrowers, I think. So I think it's just a question of getting them back on their feet and then they're going to continue to pay.
Yeah. The two big problems I see are one with the rent memorandums. You know, one of my companies is a power washing window cleaning company. We do tons of work in a multifamily space. So we're a member of the National Apartment Association. We'll actually be at the trade show in Chicago at the end of the month. You know, the rent forbearance, I think, is a big piece, you know, that could really shake out. And I don't think so much of like foreclosures, but I think homelessness could really be a problem.
Yeah, that's
You know, I know it's already a problem, and you guys are in California, right, Eric?
Yep.
Yeah. So, I mean, I know it's a problem there, not so much in Kentucky, but, you know, I think what's going to happen is we're going to have an issue when there's not enough affordable housing. You have people that haven't paid their rent. That's at $700 a month. The landlord can now kick them out. They can't find a place for $700 a month because now everything's $1,000+ and now they're living out of their car. I actually heard a stat. I was listening to the lady that runs HUD for the government the other day. She was in a Senate oversight hearing on C-SPAN. She said there's 500,000 people a night in the U.S. that are homeless. Mm-hmm. And that blows my mind. I had no idea it was that big of a number. So that's one of the things that kind of scares me from a real estate busting. The other thing that scares me is all of my real estate agent friends that I've talked to, they said that what's really been driving this crazy, insane market here in the past 12 months is the appraisers. So houses, you know, it's two parts. It's bad real estate agents that are telling their people, hey, give above asking price, waive your right to an inspection, waive your right to any contingencies. We got to give them the best deal right out the gate, which is to me is bad advice from an agent standpoint. But then on the second side is that now you have appraisers that are coming in and houses that, because they haven't had inspections on them, so the appraiser doesn't have an inspection to look at, they're not seeing some of the bad stuff in this house. So a house that maybe should only be $350,000, they're appraising that at $400,000 now or four and a quarter. Yeah. And so now you have some of that, that's where some of that inflation is coming from. And the only thing that I worry about is when interest rates start going back up, people that are in adjustable rate mortgages, if they have a house financed at $450,000, $500,000 and they're like, oh, I can make this payment at 2.6% interest. Yeah. Well, can you make that payment at 4.8% interest when your adjustable rate mortgage updates in 5 years.
Yeah,
that's
exactly.
Something that scares me a little bit, kind of on a more long term, not necessarily in the next 12 to 18 months, but a 48 to 60 month cycle looking outwards.
Yeah, and for me right now, I'm not investing in anything that's going to have an adjustable rate in the next 5 years. So unless there's some significant caps in terms of the how much the interest rate can increase.
Right.
And then I say, okay, well, what's, and then I really spend some time on my spreadsheet and say, okay, well, let's say when we go there, it's at the max possible. Like, can I afford to have this house? So I always think, you know, and you're probably the same for a lot of our real estate investors too out there, is you think about the exit. Okay. What are the different exits? What can go wrong? Even if you're holding it long-term, you want to kind of think about, okay, well, what if this happens. And then you think about it that way. And so that it also helps you kind of like, in terms of risk, managing your risk, you kind of, you sleep better at night knowing that, oh yeah, if the interest rate goes up, then it's no problem. I can do this. And so,
and I want everybody to pick up on the fact that you said you go back to your spreadsheet, which means you run the numbers.
Exactly.
That's the name of this game. You can't get caught up in the white picket fences or the, you know, the nice clean side, freshly poured sidewalks. You know, those are kind of the sprinkles, if you will. Real estate comes down to running numbers, man.
Yeah.
If the numbers make sense, it works. If they don't, walk away. It's as simple as that.
Yeah, absolutely. And then we talk about, I mean, we're kind of running out of time here. But there was so much more.
I'm known to go long on podcasts, man. I get excited. I'm just excited to be here with you guys.
Well, it's a great conversation. I mean, I'm happy to have you back, you know, later as well to continue our conversation and do a little bit deeper dive on some of these topics, especially the financing. I think, I mean, leveraging for me is critical. And I know that, and maybe that's the last topic we're going to talk about.
Okay.
Leveraging is important. Like, credit is important. You want to obviously be careful about credit. You want to make sure that it's aligned with your business objective and the timeline as well. So if you're planning to hold something long term, you know, maybe don't get into a 5-year bridge loan and then having the unknown of having to refinance 5 years down the road at what interest rate, at what at what value, and that kind of stuff. So, you know, you have to align your credit with the usability of the investment that you're doing, blah, blah, blah. But the big advantage of leveraging, obviously, is that it really increases you put less money down on the deal. And then, yes, you reduce the net cash flow. But in most cases, if I look at my investments, my return, my cash on cash return significantly increases with leveraging. So as soon as I do leveraging, you know, my return on the money that I put down is increased dramatically. So it's always a good thing to use leverage. And then the other thing too, is that the rest of the money you can invest similarly in other investments. And then your net cash flow is also going to increase as well if you invest the rest of the money instead of using leveraging. So that's the advantage. So what are your thoughts on that?
Yeah, no, absolutely. I like keeping as much cash in my pocket as possible. Mm-hmm. You know, the other side too, something that a lot of people don't realize is that if you can afford to put 50% down, you know, and again, this is going to be dependent on the market and the property. That's like always the asterisk on every real estate deal, is dependent upon the market and the property. But, you know, say you can afford to put 50% down, we'll do easy numbers, $100,000 property, and you can put $50,000 down. Well, you would be better off putting $25,000 down and then either buying another property for $25,000 down. Now you've got two properties, or where a lot of people make a lot of money that I've seen in this business is they'll put the $25,000 down and then they'll go inject the other 25 into the property. Mm-hmm. Meaning they rip out bathrooms and update those. They rip out kitchens and update those. They do new siding, they do new roofing, they do new HVAC. And so now the value of your property is increased.
Oh yeah, for sure.
You know, some of our units that we bought were, I mean, they were $9,000 12,000 bucks. I mean, they're trashed.
Yeah.
But then we had the cash to go in and put in on those.
Yeah.
You know, we bought these in a package deal, so they're individual units. But I think anytime that you can use leverage, it's a great idea. I don't see it so much. There's not so much hesitancy in real estate because, I mean, let's face it, it's big money, right? You can get into millions of dollars. You almost have to use leverage. I see it more in like small businesses to where, you know, like my power washing window cleaning company, you know, I've got a certification course. So like I tell guys, I'm like, you know, you need a $10,000 rig to really do this business professionally. Go get a bank loan. They'll put it on 5 years. Your payment will be like 200 bucks a month. You're like, you do one house wash a month and you can pay your note.
Yeah.
They're like, oh no, I don't want to do that. I'd rather take every last dollar I have in the bank that's only $1,000 and go buy and try to piecemeal this together. And so sometimes leverage in business can also put you light years ahead of a learning curve and also put you in a better position. I would urge people, go on Google and look at what the debt service and the debt load is that Walmart carries. Mm-hmm. Once I saw how much debt that Walmart carried, and they're the largest corporation in the world, that's when I was like, okay, debt's clearly not bad. Dave Ramsey doesn't know what the hell he's talking about because Walmart's doing it right. And I mean, you know, last time I checked, and this was a couple of years ago, I mean, it was like 2 to 3 times what they make in a year. Like, I mean, they're super over, you know, by the books, over leveraged, but you know, they make it work. And especially in the short term, you know, like if you think that you're going to buy a property, rent it for 5 years, and you're just looking for the cash flow, you can do interest only notes or owner financing. It doesn't, you know, leverage doesn't necessarily only have to come from the bank. Sometimes you can leverage another person. Yeah. You can say, hey man, you carry this debt. If you really need to get out of this deal, I can make it work, but you're going to have to carry the paper on it. You know, there's a lot of different ways to quote unquote leverage, but it's definitely one of the easiest ways to springboard yourself and your net worth, you know, compared to just trying to do it by good old hard work, determination, and paying cash.
Well, thank you, Coach Carroll. Well said. Great conversation. I'm sorry we have to cut this amazing discussion off. But again, so, you know, as you can see, Coach Carroll has a wide breadth of experience in real estate. So he really understands our business. And on top of that, obviously, Coach Carroll does, you know, coaching and social media and helps you with advertising strategy. So feel free to connect with him. I'll have obviously the information in the show notes. Yeah. Also, Coach Carroll has the financial literacy link. I don't have that link, so maybe you can send that to me and I'll put that in the show note as well. So I think this is financial literacy is something that's very important to me. So I spend a lot of time trying to help people do that. So I really appreciate that you put this together, this package together. And so anything else you want to add before we wrap this up?
No, I appreciate it, man. You're a stand-up guy. I really appreciate what you're doing for the real estate community. I know it's helpful. And if you guys, if you're just listening, if this is the first podcast you've caught, make sure you subscribe to the podcast. You know, there's a lot of great stuff you can learn from it. And then, you know, let's connect on social media. You can find me. I'm on YouTube, Facebook, Twitter. I drop 3 videos a week on YouTube. So just again, any of those platforms, go to the search bar, type in hashtag Coach Carroll, 2 R's, 2 L's, all one word. And let's link up. Send me a message. Let me know what you thought of the show.
Great. Thank you, Coach Carroll.
Cool. Talk Thanks, to you later. Man.
Thank you for listening to Break Away from the Rat Race with your host, Eric Martel. If you want to share your story and experience with our listeners, please message us on Facebook at Break Away from the Rat Race. Also, please subscribe to our YouTube channel and our podcast on iTunes.